when Eichmann decided he will use this town as a place for the Czech Jews, there will be 4,000 locals living here, 4,000 people approximately. So they got an order to leave. Eichmann was not waiting. You know, they would be gone. He had to send the Jewish families here, which were locked only in the two barracks. One corner of the city, you will see that barrack. It used to be a big military building. That was a place they locked the women and children. On the other side of the city was a barrack they locked the men. Now, locals lived here, and they got an order to leave, so now they're moving out. That's almost half of a year. They got to move out. So the first part of the story of Theresienstadt, when you talk about a Jewish story, it's a story where people are divided and living locked in the barracks, like in the prison. They couldn't see each other. Locals couldn't approach to the windows. They were isolated. But June 42, the real story starts. Because Nazis opened the gates in the barracks, so Jews can move out. We can move all over the city. And we were walking down the street like hypnotized. We were saying, it's so beautiful. People realized the whole city is a prison, but it was a beautiful change. And be locked only in that barracks. So that story starts June 1942. In this moment, they're dividing kids as well. They're taking kids away from the mothers. Boys are separated and girls as well. For example, this building was a home of 10 groups of Czech boys from the age of 10 to 15. See, that's why there's a sign. They'll remember, because they also created that little museum over here. Because what these boys were doing actually was very special. Theresien's story is unique in many ways, because what was happening over here was not happening in the other ghettos or the other camps. It was a social experiment of Adolf Eichmann. The stuff happening here was not a coincidence. It was all watched by Nazi clerks. So I will talk about this first. They wanted to know what's happening with their kids, with their family, with the loved ones. So the men on the other side of the city, they created a message system. Twice a day, they started to smuggle letters and messages. Twice a day. Hundreds of them, actually. To talk to each other. They found a few Czech policemen, see a few locals were involved as well. Now, the girl came here at the beginning. All these drawings originally are very small, this reproduction. Now, this is her first drawing. She sent to her father. She wanted to express herself, her feelings, because this is the last thing she was doing before she got here. See, her father sent her message back, same day actually. He was making sure she would get it as soon as possible. He sent her a message, stop immediately creating what you remember, because that stuff will just make you more and more sad. From now on, do me a favor, draw what you see.
What was her name?
Helga Weiss. Helga Weiss, she was 12 when she came. In 1942, when they opened the barracks, families had to meet each other. You know exactly where your kids are locked, where your wife, girlfriend live, and after the war, people were meeting each other. City of Theresienstadt was very busy after the war, so they had many actions with her father, Helga. Her father was sent to Auschwitz. She would never see him again. And she ended up over there at the end as well, but her father was murdered already a year and a half. See, when Nazis took over the country, as always, they took over the radio, newspapers, and they were placing these rounded announcement boards in every single street, making sure if you don't read the papers, you don't listen to the radio, you will still see what the Nazis want to tell you. Nazis start to explain always society, why the Jews are so dangerous to society. They start to explain how they control the economy, how they're controlling the bank system, how they're setting up the prices. They were explaining people, if the Jews wouldn't control the economy, well, the prices would be much lower. They were saying, look around you. Who is your supervisor? Who is your boss? Jew. In this country, for example, 70% of all doctors and lawyers would be Jewish. As we were saying, if people take the positions away from them, you'll be the one who will take over. When the Nazis started to confiscate the Jewish properties, they were always offering them to the public for very low prices. So that's why, you know, the easiest way how to explain this, if an educated person would actually protest this stuff, when they're saying they will take the factory away from the Jew, intelligent person would say, that's crazy, you cannot do this. Well, the Nazis would tell you, you'll be the one. He will take over. All of a sudden, people calm down. There will be a lot of advantages people had from these confiscations. Muslims in Palestine, they had a big demonstration pushing the British headquarters to lock the borderline. They were saying, it's too many Jews. They will take over. So they locked.
Jews couldn't go there anymore.
They knew that countries were black and borderline, so they started using their propaganda, explaining European society, nobody wants these Jews. It's going to be our task to help them to move to their own places. It's why, like, Nazis showing off, they're the heroes. They're the only ones they have to do this because nobody likes the Jews over here, as you see. Nobody likes them over there. They will create their own Aras. They will colonize the East. See, beautiful Aras, empty Aras in the middle of nature. That's the place the Jews will create their own societies. So that's why when actually first transport started in this country in November 41, everybody was aware of it. Everybody was ready for this action because Nazis were preparing a society a long time before that. Nobody would be surprised. It was called Fun Solution. Jakob Edelstein. See, there's these Jewish officers. Very soon they understood they were fooled when they had to cooperate with the Nazis. See, family members of these Jewish governments which were actually calming down their own people, explaining them what they do in the places they're sending them to in the East. That's why people trusted their own governments. Eventually, you know the destiny of each of them. They stood up against the Nazis and one after another would be executed. For example, this man behind the back of the Nazis over here, he controlled the resistance. He was smuggling, they were smuggling weapons in. He was making sure the kids would have a lot of stuff to eat, actually. Nazis believe they have a loyal clerk in him, Jakob Edelstein. Nazis were yelling in front of people, "Do you recognize your Jewish king?" This is the famous Jakob Edelstein from Theresienstadt. They shot his little son in front of everybody, Ariel. Then his wife Miriam, and then him. This is the way he died. Nazi had a very sophisticated propaganda over here as well to explain people through the Jewish office what they're gonna do over there. But people were always talking about this because certain people were spreading rumors over here because of the hidden radio. This is the first moment when people understood it might be truth because it looked like Nazi's getting ready for mass extermination. These boys felt they had an opportunity to educate all the other kids. So what these kids were creating over here would be copied by all the other groups of kids. That's why they were creating a magazine called Batel. It means we are leading. See, they tried to be on the top, and these kids had hundreds of competition over here. And that's why these names of the children which perished, they passed over here. Because of the talent of these kids, showing what these kids were able to achieve. See, there will be 10,500 kids which went through Terezin. This was a transit place, transit camp, so it means people were coming and leaving all the time. And this whole story actually, what they were doing in the meantime. Out of 10,500 kids, approximately 8,000 would be sent away from here. We will talk about these destinations in different places. 245 kids came back. None of these kids who survived were younger than 14. See, this is the names of all kids which perished. Divided in alphabetical order, and the date is the date of the birth. You can find 25 issues, 32 issues of the other magazines, or 17 issues. This magazine, Vedem, you can find 800 pages survived, 73 issues survived. That magazine is an incredible source of information because these boys, they were moving throughout the city and making interviews with the important people, even with the Czech policemen and the crematorium workers.
The Red Cross came how often?
Not much. No, the preparation for the Red Cross was taking half a year. See, that preparation was an action called beautification of Terezin. It means the social experiment of Eichmann, this city, make extra beautiful. So it means schools would be now official, legal. They were creating special spots for kids they can play. 15,000 actors were ready to perform the theater in front of the Red Cross. 15,000 actors, because the Red Cross, they arrived. Now they will be following Nazis through the city. The road was prepared. But if Red Cross would say like this, they would say, hold on a second, we go over here. Maybe we're gonna talk to that people over there, these people. Nazis were ready for this kind of behavior. That sad thing is, no need. Red Cross followed exactly to the road. They had no unpredictable turns. Problem was that European society was expecting the report about these rumors, how these Jews really live. They could report exactly the way the Nazis want. After the war, they kept saying, we were fooled. You really believe the Jewish kids have a beautiful life? The Jews have their own systems? We were fooled. They divided this floor in the section of for writers, theater people, musicians, and painters. So now look, a few names only, but definitely they had to add Peter Gynt among the famous writers. He was writing since he was 8 years old, and he ended up over here when he turned 14 because he was from mixed couple family. Father Jewish, mother non-Jewish. So he was here alone. Two years later, his sister came here because she also turned 14. She survived. She said, when I got to Terezin, first thing, of course, I wanted to see my brother. Before I reached that building, he lived in that rooms I showed you with the names. Before I reached that building, crowds of children surrounded me. This information I arrived spread all over the city. All these kids were asking me if that's true, if I'm really sister of Peter Gynt. She said she realized my brother became a star. That's because of this magazine again. Look, you can find...
Are his parents here?
Eventually, yes. January, no, not matter. A father arrived here. Basically, let me talk about the survivors. Most of the Jews who survived were from mixed couple families. Because Nazis went to murder... They didn't have to come until the January 45. Nazis went to handle these mixed couples at the end of the war, at the end. Okay. And all the others would be murdered, so it means they didn't manage. They didn't have time to do that. That's why, for example, everybody from his family survived. Okay. They grew up very quickly. Peter Gynt explaining to be kid, you couldn't afford to be kid in this place. In this place of dying. Kids were playing hide and seek among dead bodies over here. I will tell you eventually which people were dying. Now, I mentioned also they were doing interviews. They got to a crematorium and made an interview with the workers. In their magazines, which actually within 2 days, every single kid would know the stories. They're describing how woman bodies burning faster than the men's bodies. How fat leaking from their bodies supporting the fire. It kind of stopped the kids making fun of in the magazines. See, over here he said, middle of the night when everybody was sleeping, you could always hear the crying of these tough boys. It's the only moment nobody could see you, you could be kid again. I had a chance finally to ask what a bonaco really means. She was laughing. She told me we were 14, 15 years old kids. We had hundreds of dates. It was important in Terezin. We were always with the girls, actually trying to figure out which guy we should date. Bakers could give you extra bread. You can share it with your parents. Butcher was number one priority. People had a once a week small piece of meat over here. Then number one would be also Ghetto Wache, Jewish policeman. Not only they were strong young men, but they can make a living for your parents better. Yeah, so that's why they called the Bonaco. It's a nickname for whorehouse on the wheels. See, they were making fun of that stuff. Everything was actually put in a very special sense of humor. This man created a school system. This man got an idea to connect all these celebrities and educate the kids. See, he ended up in Auschwitz. He was lucky, so he survived the selection. He was sent from Auschwitz to Buchenwald. Guys, to be a survivor, it means you have to survive not one, but a few selections. Then you had to survive the death march. That's the moment Nazis running away from Soviet army. Then you had to survive the results of death march. It means typhus. He kept falling 3 days after walking in the Buchenwald death march. He couldn't stand up. Nazis just shot him. This is the way he died. Walter Eisinger, famous teacher. We can say this man established that school system in a way I described. The kids are actually looking forward to get to class. Hans Günther Adler. Despite his connections with the Franz Kafka, Mannes Group, that's a Jewish, German-Jewish artistic world of Prague, famous part of the Prague history. So he was a psychologist. In Terezin, he was a Jewish clerk in this building. He changed many offices and many positions. He had an incredible opportunity to witness Nazis and their talkings, and what he was doing, he was hiding incredible number of evidence. The communication among the Nazis, communication among Jewish officers and Nazis. Now he hid it before he left Auschwitz, and he managed to survive. See, he was saying, when we were lined up in front of Mengele, that's a doctor of Auschwitz, usually Mengele was in that place left and right in front of gas chambers. My wife turned around and she told me, I'm just letting you know, if my parents go left, I'll go with them. He said, it's the last thing I remember from my wife. He lost every single member of his family.
Now, living, this is typical accommodation of Terezin. This is luxury because this is a small room for a small group of young women working and living together. Because these rooms, and you will see that in the movie, I will show you, would go this direction. In the movie, you will see mid-sized room. These rooms would be almost the same length as the barrack. You'd be standing at the beginning of room, you wouldn't see the end. To 500 people living in one room. That's why no privacy, young people wanted to be together. That's why the last floors were known, they're for the young ones. They put the blankets, they connect the blankets with the last floor and the ceiling, and they call them apartments and villas, so they can meet each other. They were saying there was no place to be alone in Terezin. Nowhere. That's why Sunday, when actually cleaning exaggerated, they were throwing everything outside the windows. Very often they were using Cyclone B for disinfection. That powder was created to kill the rats and insects. Nobody had idea how that same stuff is used in Birkenau Auschwitz to murder people in the gas chambers. Everybody loves theater, but now why all that music and that performance has a completely different meaning to people? Why these actors, actually these artists were such a heroes, actually, and eventually many of them became legends? Because I mentioned there will be differences in entertainment. You can visit the stars. In this case, you have to buy a ticket. Now, why are you actually trying to get an expensive ticket? Not only do you have a top quality performance, but the Nazi officers sitting in the first row. Nazis knew these celebrities as well for media. They didn't want to miss that entertainment. Now, that guy actually using the Terezin language again to humiliate the Nazi sitting right in front of him. Everybody, it was very exciting because everybody knew how dangerous it is. Because everybody knew that actually at least once a month, Nazis stood up and they left the room. His grandmother wrote him back. This comedian taking the card from the grandmother before the guest chambers. And everybody's waiting for the last election. And he says, guys, in a while we will all end up in the guest chambers. I'll have to give a big advice. Granny, or my friend, sending us big advice. He started to read. She wrote, I didn't understand anything you were saying. Probably because you're confused. You forgot my advice? I've told you, you should be exercising every day and always find the time for deep breathings. He said, guys, so we will get together to the guest chambers, all together, we will do our deep breathings before we will fly quickly out of the chimney. Everybody was laughing, see. Almost everybody was murdered, also that comedian. These two guys who survived the selection were saying that guy from Terezin was so unbelievable, he made us laugh. For example, the French poet, Desnos, Robert Desnos. When people were lined up in front of the guest chambers. See, going to the last decision left and right. See, he started to say to his friends, why are you crying? You don't have to be crying. You're gonna become a rich businessman after the war. You don't have to be crying over here. And then you will bankrupt. But you will get back together again. You'll be successful. Stop crying. And why are you shaking? You're making me nervous with your shakes. See, you don't have to be shaking because you will get married after the war. You will hate your wife, but you'll have two beautiful children with her. You don't have to be shaking. And his friends start to ask him, Robert, please, quickly. They're all approaching. Left and right. So they were talking like this. They were asking, please, Robert, tell me quickly something. What am I going to do after the war? And he started to say, you and me, my friend, we'll be walking every Friday down the Champs-Élysées having good wine together. I know a very good place. You don't have to be afraid. Now, this is a very famous story because all these guys, he predicted the future. Survival selection. Eventually, they survived everything. They were saying they had a business evenings every Friday, eventually once a year, in the Champs-Élysées, one of the places. They had a meetings where eventually the whole family is talking about this artist. They were saying that Robert, he saved your lives. Because I started to smile. He was telling that story in such a funny way. All of a sudden in that horrible situation, when I was so afraid to die, I started to smile. All of a sudden I was closing my eyes and picturing the stuff he's describing. Now I stood up in front of Mengele, all smiling and all cheered up. Mengele was shocked. He said, you smile, get out of here, left, another one. They all survived like this. They
They simply were saying he changed your way of thinking.
September 1942, a few guys over here, they washed 4,000 dead bodies. The month right after that, they washed another 3,000 dead bodies. They simply refused to stop because it's the highest honor in the Jewish traditions to wash dead body. It's a proof you're an honest person when you're getting offered to be a member of burial society. This is the soil from destinations. Nazis were sending people from Theresienstadt. Soils from a place, Majdanek. Because before 26th of October 1942, before this date, Nazis were sending people to places like Majdanek, Treblinka, Izbica, Malý Trostinec, Riga. No better than Auschwitz, only using different methods of killing people. The family camp Majdanek, when people from Terezin arrived there, there would be a big sign on translation, family camp, family lager. When people arrived there after 3 days traveling, locked in overcrowded cattle wagons. By the way, also that travel today, nobody talks about this anymore. That's the worst experience of the lives of people. To be locked 3 days in that cattle wagon when people were getting hysteric, people were dying over there. They had a small bucket for toilets. It was getting very quickly full. They tried to get rid of that stuff through narrow windows. It was all falling back, so within a few hours in that wagon, everybody was smelly. Then when people were getting out,
What they experienced? Big sign family camp and Nazis were welcoming people. The biggest tragedy of Terezin starts in Wannsee Conference, when Heydrich and Eichmann decided they will send here the upper class of German Jews. These people with the connections, these old people. Again, average was between 85 to 95 years old. These people were nobility, they used to have a servant in their households, whole life. They had connections to nobility of Europe, connections of the richest businessmen of the Britain, the United States. Now, before they sent them over here, almost half of the year Nazis were explaining in propaganda in the media, that stuff spread to the rest of the Europe in the media, explaining these people getting gift from Adolf Hitler. They're getting spa city, Theresien Bad. City, they have a luxury suits and apartments with views, swimming pools, massages, daycare, servants. Now, media doing incredible job. People believe it, it's 100%. See, they had no idea what is reality. These groups of German old Jewish people have something in common that's upper class. They could afford with their money actually to buy living in this spa city. Now, New York Times writing about this as well, British papers. It was all over. Now finally they arrived. When they arrived here, they always, these groups I'm talking about, they arrived in a first class train. Eichmann was waiting in the train station personally, Adolf Eichmann. Now Nazis were bowing in front of the train because high class arrived. They were helping these people to get out of the train, helping them with the suitcases, and took them to the Terezin, to the transportation barrack courtyard. Nazis standing in the corner watching the situation. Guys, Adolf Eichmann was studying Jewish history to every single detail. That's why he was a specialist on this task, this final solution. I can tell you there are memoirs of the survivors of Jewish clerks, which before the war, Eichmann was taking care of the immigration. They were saying that all of a sudden, when these Jewish clerks were talking about, he was standing aside, handling something else. All of a sudden, he turned around and he replied Hebrew. Everybody was shocked. Actually, he can't speak Hebrew. All of a sudden, he was asking that group, where are you sending these men to Palestine? The clerks were telling him, you cannot know, it's a place of northern Palestine, it's one of the kibbutz. Eichmann asked, which kibbutz? Give me the name. They told him the name and he was able to say he knew exactly what is the purpose of the kibbutz, what is the specialty of kibbutz, where it's located, he knew everything. These Jewish clerks were always talking about who is that person, how come he knows such a details. But definitely he knew about the history. He knew about the conflict of upper class of German Jews and the Czech Jews. For generations and generations there would be a big conflict. These upper class of German Jews were looking at the Czech Jews as a low class, as a trash, as nobody. Czech Jews were hating them for this. There was a big tension always. That's why these upper class arrived to here. When Nazis in that courtyard, when they brought them in from Köln am Rhein, first transport in June 42, Nazis standing in the corner watching the situation because these old people, the luxury clothes, designer's clothes, were acting like this. Hey, don't stare at me. Take my suitcase, take me to my apartment. I'm tired of waiting over here. Why are everybody staring at us? What is it supposed to mean? Why are you laughing? You bet me she's fine line, you dirty Czech pigs. And they start to have this kind of attitude of the highest class. Nazis gave the order to take everything from them. In their suitcases, they brought the last valuables they had. They were hiding from Nazis they brought in. Now everything is gone. The place they accommodated them, the place they took them, would be space inside the walls, which looked like this. I mean, they had nothing inside. No heating, no beds, nothing. They couldn't believe these people. The Germany betrayed them like this. Because they established Germany, and I can tell you, many of them even had connections to the Nazi government. They thought they're untouchable. They were saying these people couldn't believe this is for real. They were just sitting along the wall. They were found a few days later dead in the same spot. Now, I mentioned something very important about Terezin. Guys, everybody's hungry all the time. Now, 8 o'clock evening, everybody had to be inside. For these people, I'm describing inside meant this. Before that time, they were moving throughout the city and begging people to get something to eat. Now, this was actually the idea of Eichmann. Highest class, begging, lowest class. I don't have to tell you attitude of people. Survivors were telling me major problem was their attitude after arrival. See, maybe we could help more as a group, maybe. But if you would see them, what they were saying, how they were yelling at us. With that attitude, they locked the door behind them. Now they're begging in the designer's clothes. Now, very soon, very early, they dine all over on the streets. in these walls. Winter 1942, sometimes they found 100 people frozen together inside these walls. Now, when they're begging, and that's why I told you everybody was hungry, despite that tension between these two groups, the tension was changing eventually. But when somebody begging you, and you cannot help the person, people start to learn how to ignore them. That's the saddest face of Theresienstadt. And now I can tell you Terezin's story. It's a very moving story. Survivors telling me I would never change the time. I would always go through Terezin again because I changed as a human being. Because now what started to happen? I told you children lived separately from the adults. They created their own society over here. Now children started to sacrifice their soup they were getting in lunchtime, creating lines and coming inside these walls and sharing it to these old people which were hated by the others. Now, adults were stopping them and saying, what are you doing with that soup? You cannot do this. You are in Terezin, you're going to be more hungry. Kids were explaining, adults are going to be hungry, but these people need our help. They're dying there. Adults were saying, I changed. I started to be so ashamed. I realized we're hating each other because of what? Because of nationality. Now, I can tell you, when people were visiting these lectures, this action of children would be all supported by rabbis and Christian priests. Now, they had the lectures. First, they put this advertising, the Christian priest, he was Jewish, but he was Christian, he would like to talk about Jesus. He had a crowded room because Czech Jews thought it's a big joke. He's a Jew, he's German, he's Christian, who is he? Now everybody was laughing, yelling at him, and all of a sudden Rabbi Leo Beck walked in. They shook their hands, hugged each other, and Rabbi started to say, look guys, what's happening? I just wanted to let you know that we are friends. Because if you talk about a God, we have only one God. It's always men dividing men, as the Nazis wanted to divide us. We're all Jews, you're Jew, you as well. We end up over here, we together, we have to be helping each other. People were saying that kind of stuff you would never experience outside, only in Terezin. Now people were saying I changed, I was running back to my room, I was saving a piece of cake. It was already dry, but I was saving it on a special occasion. I was running back to the wall because I remember old lady begging me from Germany. I ignored her, but she reminded my grandmother. So I tried to find her, I did. She was already dead, sitting next to the wall. I wonder how many days. Now, any help organized, which started by children, was hopeless because these people kept dying in their hands. See, people were saying it was so moving when you saw that hatred changing slowly for kindness and mercy and compassion. See, I can tell you, survivors saying, as soon as you mentioned German Jews, old people, survivors started to cry. They are telling me, I was a kid back then, I remember, I tried to help them with my mother. But we couldn't, because we didn't have what to eat for ourselves. This was the biggest tragedy. See, if I tell you 33,518 people died in the Theresienstadt, if we consider a real ghetto story, I would tell you 29,000 people died, because that's the end of 44. See, I would tell you out of 29,000, 27,000 would have a German nationality. For this upper class of German Jews, Theresienstadt was meant to be final destination. They'll be destined to die in the most humiliated way, picking up the rotten peelings of potatoes behind the barracks and begging a low class, what once upon a time they considered as a low class. Hidden shoe, hidden because it was never officially taken to registration in the ghetto. People living in this block were a different group.
and they were actually under protection of the Nazi commanders. They were heroes from the First World War. See, they had a different situation in Terezin. They lived in this block. They also believed they were protected. Because Hitler said, you know, these Jews fighting for the Germany, they will have a different story. Well, almost all of them were sent to Birkenau-Auschwitz at the end as well. But the rabbi of this place would be Arthur Berlinger. He was also a hero from the First World War. That's why he ended up over here. He had a very difficult situation in Terezin. Because to this block, the other Germans were coming and praying as well. These dying Germans. They were asking all the time, why they're forgotten by God, by people. How come the God can be so mean? How come people can be so mean? That's why he took the stuff from Book of Talmud and from Psalms, especially to support the faith. For example, over here. But despite all these, we have not forgotten your name. God, we're begging you, please do not forget us. If I will ever forget your Jerusalem, let my right hand forget its skill. Show my eyes, see my return back to Zion in mercy. This one on the left would say, would God have mercy and help our brothers, help all from the house of Israel captured on the sea or land? Would God have mercy and help them to get out of misery to relief, out of slavery to redemption? In this very moment, quickly and soon, let us pray. Amen.
This is in this country, cross. Long time ago, it lost the meaning of Christianity in this country. Cross, you place it on a graveyard, on a grave, pressing cross. And you're adding wire in the middle of the cross, it's a symbol of treason. In this case, it's a treason of Nazi regime and Czech nation. Because 95% of the prisoners which were going to this place for Czechs, see, the stories, the stuff happening behind these walls, it's the worst story of all when we talk about a Nazi regime in this country. Now, there are no real graves underneath that stones. They're all symbolic. See, randomly selected names of the prisoners which were dying in a small fort. Anyway, it's a real cemetery in the middle. Underneath a big stone, they buried the ashes of almost 3,000 people who died because of, mostly because of typhus in the ghetto. Now you have a David Starr as well.
Shiny, decorated nicely, painted nicely. This was super shiny, it had to be. If the SD guard would find a little piece of dust, commander of the room would get beat up very badly. That's why this window was sealed up, wooden boards from inside and outside, so it was a dark room. Then I can tell you I had 40 students over here. I had 40 students, nobody could move a number of 40. I would tell you a regular number of prisoners would be between 70 to 80 Jews had to live here. It means Nazis, they pushed them in. They literally squeezed them all together before they were able to lock this door. And they kept them squeezed out of this after work. Now, there would be nothing in these rooms. No toilets, no nothing. No heating. See, one professor told me, don't forget to describe the floor. Because just to approach a little bit the accommodation conditions. Imagine this room was not allowed to be cleaned up. Nazis over here, they had their own way how to keep the Jews desiccated.
they had to be standing every day. The litter of excrements and vomitings and it was getting bigger and bigger. Now they kept vomiting among each other because it's the only stuff they could breathe. The only oxygen coming in is through this little hole. Now winter time, no heating, standing in that stuff. Usually half of them had no shoes. See, I will tell you very soon which Jews end up over here.
So before that happened, Jews, the guys were saying they were badly standing. They were so sorry for these Jews. They were like walking tall. We tried to help them from the baggage room, like the Russians, but it was extremely dangerous. Because the worst crime over here was that you were captured to help a Jew over here. In the morning, Nazis were explaining to the political opponents of Nazi regime who is the real enemy of society. Jews had to create a line from left to right, badly standing. And a single Czech guy, before they moved to another courtyard, had to slap each Jew a couple times. Each Jew had to reply, "I'm stinky Jew, I tried to destroy your country." Imagine usually 700 prisoners slapping each person. They took life two or three Jews just in the morning. And other numbers were dying overnight because of the head injuries.
This actually, it means two, sometimes 3 days, the lot over here. No heating, no food, no water, and naked. In the time, it's a big difference. Now, that's why actually when these guys, Nazis, let him go back to the rooms. First thing, the guy had to drink water. Nazis always offered a glass of water. You would know you cannot touch it, but it was difficult to stay away from water when 2 or 3 days you are without. That water was extremely salty. Guys which actually were drinking that collapsed because their kidneys failed. Nazis were torturing everybody like this when they were letting them go, so they would remember, never came here again. Now, reason why this place was the worst place in the whole country was because, look, because what was happening in these rooms. There'll be 6 rooms in this section without the windows. These rooms were used for Jews. When they brought a big number of Jews at once, they locked in a number of 30 inside, so nobody can move. They locked the door and they kept them locked for 10 days. It was like a horrifying experience. Because 10 days later, Nazis opened all these doors. Czech prisoners, which were locked here, had to clean up these rooms. They always had to go through terrifying images because they always found somebody alive. The person was alive because he was eating the bodies. See, the bodies had no fingers and ears. The person alive in a state of shock was dragged to that courtyard we just went through and beaten with the shovels to death. Prisoners which went through this section, they couldn't talk about this place another 20 years after the war. They had all post-traumatic syndrome. See, Jews were ending up over here because of mistakes. Do you understand the difference between Theresienstadt and Terezin? Back then, Nazis were confused as well. I mean, not Nazis. Clerks, where we put them. Because in Czech language, we're using Terezin and Terezin. Terezin prison, Terezin city. But the Nazis divided. Theresienstadt and Terezin. So Czech name for this one, German name for that one. As soon as the Czech-German clerk working for the Nazis, and that was happening eventually quite a bit often, Jews in the different numbers end up over here by mistake, instead of the ghetto. Local Nazis always refused to give them up. They locked them in these rooms, just showed you, and I murdered them like this. All these clothes needed a whole week to be processed to go through the laundry room. There will be also women locked in this prison. Almost 8,000 women went through this place. Now many of them stay here more than a few weeks because they were sent to the other labor camps. But the job of women prisoners would be laundries. This is the way how they kept the Jews identified. Because over here, after their shower, 1 minute at the end, they had to create a line over here and take the same clothes and put them back on. These clothes were full of disinfection liquid. It was a strong chemical. Not only they were wet, they were smelly, and that's the way they kept them disinfected. That's why I'm just actually. The doctor Siler, he came here 2 weeks before Christmas, 1941. He was saying, I thought guys actually wanted to be scared because they were telling me, prisoners, that I should expect some horror scenes. I haven't seen any horror. The Nazis were acting mild, they had a good sense of humor. Kitchen was okay. I was proud of the Czech prisoners' cooks. They were doing a good job. Working in the railroad was refreshing. I felt I'm getting stronger and stronger. I got a real man job. I was thinking they're making fun of me when they were telling me this is the horror place. 2 weeks later, it was Christmas 1941. Now, he was a few days already working as an official doctor in this room. That day was beautiful, nobody had to go to work. Everybody was allowed to have Christmas trees and decorations in their rooms, in their cells. Bunch of prisoners visited the sadist, Rojko. They were begging him if they can send the candies from the package room back to the children. So much stuff arrived because of Christmas, they got this crazy idea. The Nazis kicked him out of the room, he was yelling at them. But a few minutes later, he showed up in their room and he said, "Nah, it's Christmas, go ahead, send it to your kids." Everybody was so surprised how nice he is that day. And then evening, Dr. Seiler came here because he heard noise. He had no idea what's happening. Prisoners lying here were telling him, "Go away from the window." He had no idea. He came here because he heard how prisoners running from the room to room and they were visiting each other. Now everybody's running back because SD guards were walking to the Jewish section. They dragged 20 Jews out, so now he was watching. They beat them up so they lie down on their back. All these Nazis start to jump on their chest as crazy. He said their heads turned completely red. They looked as crazy devils. He was screaming when he saw this. They finished, lit up the cigarettes, and they just walked away. He was running there, tried to help them. He said, "I couldn't. They were all murdered right in front of my eyes." He was standing next to the dead bodies when Nazis came back. They were joking, smiling, like nothing happened. He said, "In this moment, I realized I'm in the middle of the hell." This was his first experience. He described an incredible number of that stuff in his book.
See, after the war, they brought his Jews to this hill. Two or three Jews were selected. I say two or three because it always depends how many Jews died over the day. And at the end, the Nazis selected two or three. They gave them the shovels. They had to be digging straight into that hill. The rest of the group had to climb on the hill and they had to keep jumping on one spot. Everybody had to keep jumping. Because these two or three Jews were eventually deep enough, so the top collapsed and buried them alive. Nazis considered as entertainment. Always another guards and officers came there because the Jews be fighting for survival. They tried to get through the dirt. As soon as they managed, Czech guys had to take the shovels and finish them off. These two ways I just told you were switching every other day between 1940 to the beginning of 1944. Then the commander of that group, Storch, was sent to the Eastern Front. So another commander took over. So they were changing the stuff of torture, way of torture. 10 years old girl, daughter of Nazi commander, Hannah. She persuaded her father to change the water tank to be a swimming pool. 38 Jews were tortured to death just to build it. Whole story behind it. Because Nazi wives and their friends considered as entertainment, they gave the order to prepare the tables and chairs around the pool with alcohol cigarettes and watching that stuff. Eventually, when these family members of Nazis, when they were getting drunk, very often they gave the order to the Rojko to bring 10 Jews over here. Now they're all sitting around drinking alcohol. These Jews had to get naked, jump in. Rojko told them only one of them can get out. They had to all drown each other in front of Nazi wives. Again, these women consider that as entertainment. This is just, again, one example of what they were doing over here. See, now when you hear these few stories, you understand why this place changed after the war to be prison for Nazis. I can tell you most of them were caught. They were locked in the isolation cells I showed you. They were interrogated almost a year before one after another would be executed. Nazi commander Jokl spent almost a year in the Jewish cell I showed you. Now I can tell you their family members were locked here as well. None of them survived this place.